Hi, my name's Dustin Whittle, and thank you for joining. This is Performance Testing Crash Course. Is that a little better, everyone?
Yeah, there we go.
All right, so hopefully this works. So a little bit of background on me. I'm a developer evangelist at a company called AppDynamics that does application performance monitoring. Before that, I was a consultant and trainer for a company called Sensio Labs. They're the creators of the Symfony PHP framework and a bunch of PHP tools. And then previous to that, I brought Symfony to Yahoo to rebuild properties like Yahoo Answers, Delicious, Yahoo Bookmarks, etc. So I've been working on some large properties for quite a while. But why does performance matter? So Microsoft found that Bing searches that were 2 seconds slower resulted in a 4.3% drop in revenue per user. When Mozilla shaved 2.2 seconds off their landing page experience, the Firefox downloads increased 15.4%. So they got 30 million more downloads just because the page was slightly faster. And making Barack Obama's website 60% faster increased donation conversions by 14%. So he raised $60 million more just because the page was a little bit faster. But my favorite stat of all of these is when Amazon and Walmart increased their revenue 1% by every 100 milliseconds, they shave off the end user latency. So the reality is that performance directly impacts the bottom line. And all the major tech companies really invest a lot in the performance because they understand that actually it affects their business. So again, performance directly impacts the bottom line. But how fast is fast enough, right? So most users will abandon a page. After 3 seconds because they people quickly lose confidence. So how does your brain perceive page load times? So the whole goal is to make it feel instantaneous, like you're flipping a page in a book. So 100 milliseconds feels instantaneous. A second allows you to keep your train of thought and think seamlessly. After 10 seconds, people drop off remarkably, and you really can't focus, and people lose confidence. So if you're in an e-commerce transaction, you're checking out, and you click checkout with your credit card information, you wait 30 seconds, you are, okay, what's happening here? So I'm not sure this is probably localized for the right audience, but in the US we had a major failure because it's not just about the raw performance. Your site also has to be available for users to register. So we tried to launch national healthcare in the US and they launched healthcare.gov. And the problem was everyone showed up on the first day and everything was completely broken. They didn't do any performance testing. They didn't understand why things were broken. And it's the first time I've ever seen a president come on live TV and apologize for a broken website. Some tools of the trade for performance testing. These are just the different approaches I've used to evaluate basically doing capacity planning on the server side and performance testing on the client side. So really it starts with understanding your baseline performance. You know, it really doesn't matter the tech stack that you use. Performance testing is relatively the same across, you know, whatever X framework. So it really starts with what can Apache handle by itself on this size hardware or Nginx or whatever your flavor is. And then after that, you really want to just test what can my language handle. So if I do hello world in Python or PHP, what's that benchmark? And then what's hello world in my framework? So what's the added overhead of the tool set that I'm using? And then again, the entire stack. So today I'm really going to be talking about testing the entire stack. So how many of you are familiar with Apache? Okay, then you've likely used Apache Bench before. Apache Bench is relatively straightforward. What it does is it just sends a bunch of concurrent requests to a website and gives you performance metrics around them. So here I want to call AB, Apache Bench, with a concurrency of 10 users for a time of 10 seconds to my URL in benchmark mode. And what this will do is send 10 concurrent users for 10 seconds and give me the performance metrics. Pretty straightforward and pretty basic. So what you can see is that I get about 28 requests per second on my website, which is pretty horrific. And the average latency is 351 milliseconds. Not very good. I prefer Siege just because if you need a simple way to benchmark sites, Siege is just a bit more configurable. So Siege, the same command is quite straightforward, Siege-C with a level of 10 concurrency, and -B is benchmark mode with a time of 10 seconds to this URL. And you get a very similar output. So again, it's about 28 transactions a second. And it's quite slow at about 350 milliseconds response time. Now, this is fine when you want to benchmark a single URL. But what happens when you want to discover all the URLs in your application and then load test actual user load across the entire app? So what I've discovered is a decent solution for this. There's a tool that comes packaged with Siege called S-Proxy. It just provides a transparent proxy. So you can download this. It's just Google Siege. And basically, you start sproxy with sproxy-o for output to a file. And all I want to do is crawl an application as if I was a search engine, and output all the URLs to this list to a text file. So you start sproxy. And then I use wget, which is a quite useful utility. But what I like about wget is it has a spider mode, which basically will recursively crawl every page in your application. So you can simply point it at your home page and then have it crawl the rest of the traffic, crawl the rest of the site. And all you do is pass in a HTTP proxy, and then all the URLs that wget crawls will end up in a file. And then you just want to make that the list of URLs unique. So I just simply sort dash u. And now I have a list of unique URLs across my entire application. Then it becomes easy to benchmark traffic across all unique URLs with Siege. So Siege-V for verbose because I want a lot of output, -C concurrency of 50 users this time, for -T of 3 minutes from this file urls.txt with -D is a delay between requests of 10 seconds. So this is pretty straightforward when you just want to load test a single application from one single machine. And if you don't prefer the command line, if you're more GUI oriented, then there's Apache JMeter I'm quite a big fan of. Apache JMeter, it gives you a GUI that allows you to create test plans. The benefit of Apache JMeter is you can actually load test a lot more than just HTTP. So if you want to load test your IMAP server or various other services, it's very easy to use and it gives you a graphical UI. All right, by a show of hands, how many people are developers in the audience? So just a few. All right, and how many people are operations or operations professional of some kind? All right, good to know. So when you want to just benchmark the raw performance of your homepage, or you just want to get an idea of the performance across your entire application, Apache Bench and Siege are good utilities for that. But sometimes you need to do more than that. Sometimes you want to document, you want to performance test specific flows. So how long does it take for me to go to the home page, click on the sign-in link, go through the sign-in process, add something to a cart, fill out some information, and check out? And then what's the performance characteristics of each one of those transactions? So there's a great Python framework I've discovered called multi-mechanize. So multi-mechanize is an open source framework for performance and load testing. It's very easy to install and get started. Simply pip install multi-mechanize. And then you'll have a command line available to you. So there's the multi-mech new project command, where you can just bootstrap a new project pretty easily. So multi-mech new project, and then a name of a project. And really all it does is give you a framework for testing transactions, and then a way to manage custom timers. So again, I'm basically going to do the same load test. All I want to do is fetch my personal homepage. And you can use any library. So here I'm using the Python request library, but really you can do whatever you want inside of a transaction. All that multi-mechanize does is run transactions at high levels of concurrency and provides great reporting and statistics on top of that. So maybe I want to do something more complicated, like I want to go to my homepage and then go to my blog and do an aggregate of each one of these transactions. So one, you can see I can use the multi-mechanized browser. So sometimes you require to maintain state between transactions. So if I want to log in, I need a way to persist the cookie. So I actually have to emulate the cookie and create a cookie jar. Multi-mechanized actually has the mechanized browser, which can help you maintain the state. So here, I'm going to open a request using the multi-mechanized browser, go to dustinwhittle.com, and then just add some latency. So here we just have so we have the start time, and then I'm just going to fetch the page and basically track a custom timer of the latency of just the home page. So the start time minus the end time gives you the duration of the latency for that request. And then I want to do the same thing by going to the browser and going to my blog, so dustinwhittle.com/blog. This is great if you need to go through complex flows and you need to understand the performance characteristics of each particular transaction. And it's really easy to extend and customize to fit almost any application. So you have some basic settings. It's really highly configurable. So here, the runtime, I just want to run it for 10 seconds. I want to ramp up over 5 seconds. And then in the graphs, I want the intervals, the timestamp intervals to be 1 second. And then I can create different groups. So I can run different transactions together. So this might be one transaction where I just fetch the home page. And then I have another transaction, which is fetch the home page and then go to a blog. And I want to run these in different groups. So here I just want to run thread calling this demo.py, which is this particular class. I run multi-mech run-demo. And what you'll get is it'll run your load test in the background and produce some nice graphs. And this will basically give you, it'll plot the raw response time in a graph and then give you some averages. But how many of you live in the cloud? Well, that's just sad. All right, how many of you are in a data center co-located somewhere? All right, so you're all in a cloud some kind, just the old cloud. All right, so what about when you need more than one machine? Real applications are highly complex. It's not just a single machine. And a lot of times when you need to load test them, you're going to require more bandwidth than a single machine or more CPU resources. Usually you exceed your bandwidth before that. So I've discovered an awesome library called Bees with Machine Guns. It's built by the Chicago Tribune. Number one, just check out that awesome logo I would like to point out. Come on. So what is Bees with Machine Guns? It's a utility for arming mini bees to attack targets, where you're creating micro EC2 instances to generate load against web applications. This is the only open source project I know that comes with a caveat that it's a felony to do this against any other site besides your own, because effectively it's a distributed denial of service attack. So again, this is a nice Python library. It's quite simple and straightforward. You can simply pip install bees with machine guns. And then all you need to do is it uses the Bodo Python library underneath, so you need to define some EC2 credentials. So you just give it an AWS access key ID and an access key secret. And then you can say which availability zone do you want to test from. So you can set up multiple instances of these and run them concurrently if you want to generate load from various places around the world, but it's quite easy to configure. So once you've defined this configuration file and you've installed bees with machine guns, it's pretty easy to bring up instances. So you can call bees up with the security group, the availability zone, and AMI ID, which basically just has Siege and a bunch of load testing tools already built into it, and then the SSH key that you're going to use to log in and the username. So we have bees up with S, the number of servers that I want to bring up, the availability zone, so I want this to be based in Oregon in the US, and then the username and SSH key that I want to authenticate with. These guys have a really hilarious sense of humor. So when you run bees up, it's going to connect to the hive. It's going to attempt to call up two bees. They're going to wait for the bees to load their machine guns, so boot up. And then when the bees are ready for attack, you can start using them. So it'll say the swarm has assembled two bees. You can simply call bees report to see how many instances are in the roster. Pretty straightforward. And then you can increase the level of concurrency. So if you need to throw 100,000 requests concurrently at a target, it's very easy to do just by spinning up multiple EC2 instances. If you're running this off your MacBook or from an EC2 instance in a data center, you'll quickly run out of network bandwidth to generate that high level of concurrency, where Bees with Machine Guns makes it really easy to do this distributedly. So if you want to load test against a website, it's pretty straightforward. You can simply call bees attack with the number of transactions you want to run and a level of concurrency. So in here, 50, but I could go up to 50,000 if I'd like. And then a URL. So again, my personal website. This time I threw in Varnish in front of it so I get a little bit better results. But again, it's going to read two bees from the roster. It's going to connect to the hive and assemble the bees. Each of the two bees will fire off 50,000 rounds, 125 at a time, seeing the URL so it will be cached for the attack. So B0 will join the swarm, fire its machine gun, bang, bang. And then B1 will fire its machine gun, bang, bang. And then it'll basically tell you the offensive is complete. And either the target will crush the B offensive or it won't. And it'll give you some background information. So how many requests were completed, what was the average latency, and what were peak transactions per second. So if you need to test high levels of concurrency, this is a really easy way to do it. And then when you're done, because the cloud's cost, the benefit of using the cloud is cost scale linearly with demand. You want to make sure that you want to call bees down so it kills off your EC2 instances when you're done with them. All right, so that's a bit about the server side, but what about the client side? The reality is in modern web applications, more latency comes from the client side than the server side, so you need to actually performance test this too. If you're using a lot of JavaScript in your website, the users are probably spending more time waiting for the resources to download and then DOM become available. So there's a bunch of tools that allow you to do that. So, Google PageSpeed. How many of you have used Google PageSpeed before? All right, so for those of you that haven't, cool PageSpeed is a set of tools that allow you to analyze and optimize your website and basically provide performance recommendations for how to optimize the front end. And they do this through a few different avenues. So there's Google PageSpeed Insights as a website where you can simply go and drop in your URL. My personal favorite is if you use Chrome, there's developer tools. There is an extension for this. But my favorite is really because it's Google and they're awesome, they release everything as an API. So they actually have a PageSpeed API so that you can integrate this into your continuous integration flow. So you simply call curl googleapis.com/pagespeed online, and then you pass in your key. And what that'll give you is a JSON blob and a set of results on how to optimize. So I'm not sure if I can zoom in here. All right. But basically what it has is recommendations for how to improve performance. So I should avoid using redirects. I should cache some CSS and JavaScript, apply JavaScript and CSS, and then reduce the request size. So it's very specific on how to improve performance on the client side. The W3C released the navigation timing APIs that allow you to, within JavaScript, easily track client-side performance and give you some basic metrics. The problem is it's easy to do in JavaScript, but how do you automate that so you don't have to manually spin up a browser every time? And I've discovered a great tool called WBench. WBench will basically give you client-side timing breakdowns, so it's easy to install. So gem install WBench, and then you can simply call the command WBench and then a URL. And what this will give you is a breakdown of the W3C navigation APIs. So here, how much time, what's the first byte time? So how much time am I waiting on the server side? How much time am I waiting in DNS lookups, in SSL negotiation, waiting for assets to download like CSS and JavaScript, waiting for the DOM to render? And as you change your application, you can see the performance improvements. Because just because you added a feature doesn't mean you haven't slowed down the entire application, especially in really complex client-side applications. So how many of you use Grunt or have heard of Grunt before? All right, so if not, you should be using it. Basically, the point is to automate client-side performance testing using Grunt. So I'm a big fan of these tools. So I use Bower for managing my front-end dependencies. I use Grunt for automating tasks. And then I use EOMAN for bootstrapping projects. So if you haven't discovered any of these, please go check them out. Specifically about Grunt, though, it's a task runner and written in Node. And the nice thing about this is you can use it to manage all of your front-end dependencies and to build out your application and run tests on it. And they have a lot of extensions and integrations, and one of those is Grunt PageSpeed. So with Grunt PageSpeed, it basically allows you to just run Grunt, have PageSpeed as a task, and get output from the API directly, and it abstracts it and makes it extremely easy for you. So how many of you would say you work for a reputable web company? There are remarkably few hands up right now. All right. So how many people understand exactly how fast their website runs in production? Yeah, not as many as I would expect. Part of load testing is understanding when you run load tests, where do things slow down? Are you exhausting your app server front-end connections? Are you exhausting database connections? Are you saturating memcache requests? Is it disk I/O, network I/O, et cetera? So you really need to track performance and development and production. And this is more targeted toward the operations folks, because you really need to instrument everything. And to understand where you're having problems, you need to have visibility. So you need to track as many performance metrics as possible. So there's a bunch of great solutions I found for this. So again, instrument everything. Instrument your code, instrument your database calls, caches, query queues, third-party services, and then all of your raw hardware and infrastructure. So I'm not going to get in a big debate or get to dive into deep into this, but I'm a big fan of Chef and Sensu. The Chef and Sensu combination is really great. It allows you, I use AWS a lot of the time. It allows me to automate infrastructure and then to handle configuration management by defining roles. So I have a web server that has Nginx on it. I have a Postgres instance that's is it my database role. And then Sensu is an open source monitoring framework that allows you to do health checks. And part of health checks is gathering stats. right? So if I have a database role, there is a Postgres health check that'll pull, okay, how many open database connections are there? What's the average read latency? What's the average write latency? There's an Nginx role, and basically Sensu will allow you to say, if this is Nginx, apply all the Nginx health checks. And that'll allow you to get granular metrics, like what are the current number of open HTTP connections, the average latency, et cetera. So if you haven't ever discovered this, check this out. But once you have the health checks, and once you're able to pull metrics from Nginx and Postgres and Redis and RabbitMQ or whatever your tech stack is, you need to be able to store them and make them accessible and useful. So a great combination that I found in the open source world is Etsy, is an e-commerce company based out of New York that released something called StatsD. Basically, it's a really easy way to track metrics. Graphite is a graphing library for time series data and metrics. And then Grafana is a UI front end for those metrics. So what you can use is Chef to automate your infrastructure, Sensu to automate your health checks and stats collection. You plug all those health checks and that stats into StatsD, and then you can graph them into Graphite, and then you have a sexy dashboard that looks like this of all your raw metrics. So at any point in time, I can say, tell me, while I'm running my load test, how many Nginx open connections are there? What's the average read latency on my database? Cache hit miss ratio in Redis or Varnish or various caching mechanisms. I think a lot of people forget when you're going to run load tests, make sure that the load that you're generating actually tells you useful information. And that's really about instrumenting all of your code and all of your infrastructure. Now, that's on the server side, and that's for the infrastructure, but what about on the client side? So there's Episodes and Boomerang. One of the guys who worked at Yahoo way back released something called Boomerang, and Steve Souders, who runs Velocity and originally worked on Google PageSpeed, released something called Episodes. All they do is beacon their performance results using the W3C navigation APIs. So it's a piece of JavaScript that you can include that will automatically track the real end user performance. And again, all this stuff is open and free. So there's a couple different uses for Boomerang. One is measuring a page perceived performance. How slow is this for actual users? Because the experience is going to be different everywhere. It's not just server-side time, but also the client-side time. If my only server is in California in the US and I'm pulling it from South Africa, there's a lot more network latency. So you really need to get insight into your actual users. It's one thing to do this in a test in a simulated environment, but the best information comes directly from your existing users, and it's very easy to add. And then Episodes does something slightly similar. It's just a little less granular. And what it'll give you is like page load time. I'm not sure how legible this is.
Nope. Fail.
All right, so basically what it does is it gives you a granular JavaScript API to track performance, and then you can report this performance to the server side so that you can store these stats in something like StatsD by using beacons. So here's an here's the URL to an image with a bunch of parameters, which are these performance timings. And you can track all that stuff in StatsD. But there's a ton of services that also can provide this if you just want to do this for one-off requests. So I've gone through a bunch of open source solutions, so now, how many of you are familiar with webpagetest.org? All right, so I use this service all the time. Basically what it is you can drop in a URL, and you can pick a location, a network, a speed. Like, I want to test this from Sydney, Australia, over a DSL connection, and I want to understand the performance. And what it'll give you is this report. So one, if you ever need a screenshot, it's really good for creating screenshots. It'll also record a video. But more importantly, it'll give you all the client-side timings, the server-side latency, as well as a waterfall view of what was happening on the client side. So it's like having Chrome DevTools in a million locations with a million different browsers. So if you want to test and screenshot Firefox versus Safari versus iPhone versus an Android, you can do that all through web page test. And the best bit is that they have an API available. So again, if you want, you can automate this and make it happen every time you do a deployment or every time you do a commit. So the next thing I'm going to talk about is sitespeed.io. Sitespeed.io basically allows you to analyze website speed and performance and gives you granular metrics for both the server side and the client side. But the best bit is it allows you to do JUnit output, so it's very easy to integrate with Jenkins and build custom reports around. So what it looks like is if you're on Mac, it's really easy to install using Homebrew. It's really easy to install on Linux and Windows as well. But basically, it gives you a command, sitespeed, where you can just call sitespeed.io-h with a host, and you'll get a bunch of benchmarks. So it'll give you the page speed score, right? It'll tell you the end user latency, how many DOM elements you have, and a bunch of really useful client-side metrics. So as you're committing code, you can see the actual impact between every release. So including document weight, JavaScript file weight, CSS, and it gives you useful metrics, like how many requests didn't have gzip encoding, how many requests didn't have caching, how many domains were involved, how much time did I spend on SSL negotiation versus DNS lookups, et cetera. And then there's the company that sent me here. We're AppDynamics. We basically do application performance monitoring, so we instrument all of your infrastructure and your code. We monitor the client side. We give you granular breakdown of performance times. And it's available free for a single application, so everyone can check it out. But more importantly, just like the open source combination of StatsD and Graphite, you can throw any metric at us, and we can track it over time. So a lot of this is great if you're an engineer or operations. It's really easy to apply most of these tools. But sometimes it's easier just to buy it than it is to build it yourself. So I'm a fan of Blitz.io. Blitz.io is a really easy way to load test your site. You simply authenticate that you own the site by adding an HTTP header, and then you can send up to 50,000 requests concurrently, and it gives you a nice graphical UI so that you can load test results. There's a bunch of these services now, so I'm only going to mention a few, but there's three that I like. Blitz.io, it's very cheap to do, so if you're going to pay for AWS costs, you might as well just pay for Blitz. Apica is better just if you need global tests, so if you want to test from a bunch of locations around the world. And also you can do up to a couple million concurrent users. And then BlazeMeter, which is a cloud web-based JMeter equivalent. Now most people, they only test for success. And this is really bad, because what happens when things break? What happens if you lose your Memcache cluster and all of a sudden there's a surge in requests to the database? So Netflix has released their Simian Armian toolset, which includes something called Chaos Monkey. Basically, what it'll do is go into EC2 and increase the network latency between colos, between availability zones. It will go and randomly kill instances, shut down ports, and basically create a bunch of chaos in your network to allow you to test and simulate for unknown failures. Part of load testing is figuring out not only the baseline of what your application can handle, but what happens when things start to fail. But not only what happens when your infrastructure starts to fail, but what happens when third-party services you have no control of start to slow down. So if you rely on PayPal API and PayPal for some reason hangs, do you automatically fail and exponentially back off and retry? Or you just sit there and wait 20 seconds for the connection to die and therefore block the end user request? These are all things you really should check for. So Netflix has done a lot of great open source work, and they've released a bunch of tools that help solve this in cloud environments. They're largely based in EC2, so most of them are targeted at EC2. So around performance best practices, you really should capacity plan and load test the server side. I've given some basic tools and I've walked through them pretty quickly. All of these slides are available on speakerdeck.com/DustinWhittle with a lot of notes at the end of it. So if you really want to understand where to go to get started and the actual code, there's links to all of this at the bottom of the slides. Optimize and performance test on the client side. Again, you spend more time there than on the server side. You really need to capacity plan. You have to be proactive about, if you're going for a big launch, you don't just guess that, okay, I think we need three servers and throw it out there and see what happens. You really need to be proactive about load testing and capacity planning. And part of that is just understanding what's expected traffic, and then understanding the performance of your application and matching the two. A lot of people don't track underlying performance metrics, so you really need to understand your starting point and then instrument everything in between. So measure the difference of every change. I think a lot of people, you know, they do load test once when they initially release the application. They do 2 years worth of work and they never run another performance test, so they don't understand how much performance has changed over time. And then automate performance testing as part of your build and deploy process. Using Grunt and a bunch of tasks through Grunt and all the APIs through these services, you can really easily get performance testing on every commit. You can do a performance report as part of your Jenkins build. It includes both page speed, site speed metrics, and really understand what's changing as you release each feature. And then understand how failures impact performance. Pretty straightforward. So just to surmise, Integrate automated performance testing into continuous integration for both the server side in terms of load testing and performance testing on the client side. And then understand the performance implication of every deployment and package change. If you upgrade from MySQL 5.5 to 5.6, did that improve or hurt your read latency? If you upgrade PHP from 5.4 to 5.5, what's the impact of that on your application? The one nice thing that I've started to notice is I've had applications that have been long-lived for several years and I've upgraded packages. As you upgrade PHP or Python, as you upgrade Postgres or MySQL, you can slowly see the latency and the overall latency go down every release. So PHP 5.5 is a bit faster than PHP 5.4. Postgres 9.4 is faster than Postgres 9.1. And you can really start to see the impact across package changes and application deployments. And then really, in order to make informed decisions, you need data. So monitor the end user experience, not only the server side, but the client side, and do it from your real users, right? The best data comes from every user, and it's relatively lightweight to add with tools like Boomerang and StatsD. And I went a bit fast, so that's all I have for you. So I'd like to open it up for any questions.
Cool. That was a whistle stop back to front tour. Anyone got any questions?
We have time to do it again.
Hi. You mentioned a couple of tools you use to monitor from the cloud. And I was just interested in your take on New Relic, if you've ever used it.
Yeah, I think New Relic's a great tool. It's a bit simpler. So I actually wrote a case study for New Relic on Python. I was a CTO of a tech company called Porter in San Francisco who did online gaming, and we used New Relic for our entire Python tech stack. I think it's remarkably good. The problem is it's for simple applications. So when you have large distributed applications, a lot of the problem when you have a service-oriented architecture is figuring out which node is the actual problem. And I think we do a better job at that. But the point isn't using one over the other. It's as long as you have something. So I tried to provide, here's an open source way to do this. Here's a tool that you can purchase. As long as you have something, whether it's StatsD and Graphite, and tracking all your performance metrics manually, you can do that for free and open source. You can pay for services like AppDynamics, New Relic, CompuWare. They all do basically the same thing. They all have different pros and cons. But you really just need to get insight into the server side, actually like the call graph. So when you have a slow request, you know which method is actually slowing things down. Is it a database call, waiting on a queue, waiting on a third-party service? And then the client side. Those tools, application performance management tools, just make it easier to buy it in a box and install it in one line. But thanks for plugging my competitor.
What kind of overhead do you see with these adding these monitoring tools?
Yeah, so it depends which one. They all sort of slightly differ. Something like adding Boomerang is extremely lightweight on the client side. You're talking maybe 2 milliseconds on every user request. If you're using something more heavyweight like AppDynamics or New Relic, it greatly depends on the language. So if you're using Java and you can use the Java agent APIs, the overhead is like 2% fixed. Just because it's bytecode instrumentation, it's extremely fast. And other languages like PHP and Python, you actually have to make yourself part of the call and do manual timings on every call. So it just depends on the complexity of the application, how deep the call graph is. I generally find it's between about 2% and 5%, but it greatly depends on the tool. For this level of information, I think 5% is pretty reasonable. Very large companies, every major modern internet company has this infrastructure and collects these metrics, so this stuff's really built for production.
In a world of microservices, where services call other services. Performance testing sort of a user-ending service becomes quite difficult because of the threat of accidentally taking down all the other services behind your stack. Do you know of any good tools to sort of like mock out those connections behind your front-end service that you're actually trying to test without killing everything else behind it?
So I don't think you must test the end-to-end time. So I think you should instrument every single one of those back-end service calls. So a lot of times it's just small, many concurrent calls to a variety of different services. And you should check the performance of one of those. So I believe that it's not just measuring end user time. It's just about the depth of instrumentation. Do I know any tools? So most of the APM tools we talked about all do something similar to that, where they instrument every exit point. So they instrument every call to a third-party web service, whether it's yours or internally or externally, every call to a database or a cache or a queue, and they'll give you the latency of each one of those. There's some open source tools. I can't remember the name of it, but Twitter just released one that basically does distributed transaction tracing across different application languages. So if I have one service built in Java, I have another service built in Python, PHP, et cetera, et cetera. What they do is give you a way to tag and follow the request across the different languages, and they give you granular performance timings for each one of them. But more importantly, they make it easy when you're having problems to drill down into the tier, into the service that's actually causing the problem. Because I have a checkout transaction. I might have one checkout transaction that goes to my front-end e-commerce node, but really in the back, I'm inserting something into an order queue. Then I might have a Java service pulling something out of that order queue. I might be talking to PayPal's API for payment information, FedEx's API for shipping information, and you really need to understand for each one of those services where the bottleneck is. And I really wish I could remember it. Twitter.github.io, and you'll find it. But basically what it allows you to do is to drill down into each one of those tiers to figure out where you're having problems. But AppDynamics, New Relic, they all sort of are built on that notion, visibility into the complex apps.
So a lot of the stuff you've covered is very specifically web servers and web apps and such.
Yeah.
Let's say you have to integrate with some kind of like non-default protocol, maybe an audio system or some kind of enterprise database system, weird protocol thing. Have you got any kind of recommendations for what kind of applications you can use to load test those kind of things?
Yeah, so multi-mechanize, it's about transactions. It's really just a performance testing framework for transactions, so you can test anything inside a transaction. So if I want to test an IMAP server, so let me backtrack a little bit. JMeter actually has support for LDAP, IMAP, like there's hundreds of services out of the box. Multi-mechanize, anything that you can to in Python, you can do performance testing on at large levels of concurrency. So I think between the two of those, you can cover most services. Yeah. If you can't, so I think StatsD and Graphite is a very versatile combination because you can track, you decide the timing and you just throw in the metric there and then you can evaluate it. So as long as you can open a connection, you can do a start time before, an end time, do the difference, and that's your latency, right? There are, I'm sure, better tools. It just depends on the specific use case.
Cool. At the back.
Was it?
Hello. There we go. Hey. Okay. So when you have multiple performance testing tools. Two questions. How have you in the past stopped them from influencing your analytics? And if you have multiple performance testing tools running simultaneously, how do you create awareness of each other? Because you might want to have 10 concurrent connections, but two performance things hitting at the same time, technically you get 20 concurrent connections.
Yeah, so a lot of this I try to do most of the time. So again, a lot of the resources I use are based in the cloud, so it's relatively cheap for me to reproduce my entire production infrastructure as a staging environment, and I load test against that. So that keeps it from impacting end users, but that also keeps different performance tests from impacting each other. The second one I think is really just a bit about communication. Right. If your team's well organized, it's very clear that you can say, hey, you know, this cluster is dedicated to this cause, or we're taking down this service. Yeah. Does that answer it? Any other questions?
Even if it doesn't answer it, I'm not coming back. Cool. Right. Great. Well, thank you for that. And let's give him a round of applause.